I'm going to jump right in. Season 4, Episode 3 of Seinfeld is entitled The Pitch. It premiered in America on September 16th, 1992. In this episode, Jerry Seinfeld is asked by NBC if he would pitch a television show that would be based on the life of his character. This conversation ensues.
And who's on the show? Who are the characters?
I could be a character.
You?
Yeah, you base a character on me.
So on the show, there's a character named George Costanza?
Yeah. What, there's something wrong with that? I'm a character. People are always saying to me, you know, you're quite a character.
And who else is on the show?
Elaine could be a character. Kramer.
Now, he's a character. So everybody I know is a character on the show.
Right.
And it's about nothing.
Absolutely nothing.
So you're saying I go into NBC and tell them I got this idea for a show about nothing.
We go into NBC.
We? Since when are you a writer?
What writer? We're talking about a sitcom.
You want to go with me to NBC?
Yeah, I think we really got something here.
What do we got?
An idea.
What idea?
An idea for the show.
I still don't know what the idea is.
It's about nothing.
Right.
Everybody's doing something. We'll do nothing.
So we go into NBC, we tell them I got an idea for a show about nothing.
Exactly.
They say, what's your show about? I say nothing.
There you go.
I think you may have something here.
Okay, so here's what's happening in this clip. Jerry Seinfeld has been asked to pitch a situation comedy to NBC. That would be based loosely on the life of his character. Here he is talking with his best friend, George Costanza, about how they're going to author a script to pitch to NBC. Jerry asks his friend, how are we going to write this show? And the response is, what are you talking about writing? We're talking about a sitcom, right? And the joke is, first, that the people authoring Seinfeld are kind of making fun of themselves and sort of where the whole idea of an American situation comedy sits within American television, right? But the laughter is also funny because it's very revealing about the way that Americans were looking at television in the final decade of the 20th century, really looking at this kind of box as a source of entertainment. I want to skip ahead 12 years to March 27th, 2015. This is an interview. Barack Obama asked to interview David Simon. David Simon is the creator of The Wire. This itself is extraordinary that a sitting president would want to interview an American producer. Obama introduces his interview by confessing to David Simon that he's a fan of The Wire.
At the front end, I got to tell you, I'm a huge fan of The Wire. I think it's one of the greatest, not just television shows, but pieces of art in the last couple of decades. I was a huge fan of it.
My point is, between Seinfeld and Obama's interview with David Simon, much changed in American culture and much changed about Americans' relationship with the entire idea of television. Here's my purpose. If we start in the upper left there, I've listed a chronology of debuts of four serial dramas on American television. The Sopranos debuted in 1999, The Wire in 2002, Deadwood 2004, and Mad Men in 2007. My purpose is to suggest that these shows represent a new American aesthetic, or perhaps in reverse, that these shows introduced profound American aesthetics into American television and therefore sort of mark a new relationship, really a revolution in the way that Americans understand and relate to television. In order to fully appreciate this, I think there's kind of two points of entry we need to take to understand where these shows come from. The first is to understand what I call an evolution of an American crisis of conscience. And this is about a two-decade process that precedes the debut of these shows. The second is a kind of review of America's documentary aesthetic. And I'll note specifically that in the final decade of the 20th century, Americans became, obsessed isn't the right word, but deeply, deeply interested and emotionally attached to new ideas about American history. My point is that these two things converge and you see the production of these shows merge. So I start with this, America's crisis of conscience. I think the cleanest way to begin this discussion is to start here. This is 1974. Gerald Ford, the then new president of the United States, pardoned Richard Nixon. quickly, let me summarize this as follows. Richard Nixon was caught in exercising abuses of power. He had abused power, he had broken laws, and he had really sort of corrupted the whole idea of the American presidency. And all of this played out in front of the American public. Ford decided to pardon Nixon, right? And I think that sort of sets a precedent for future sort of corruptions in American culture that finally manifests in the shows I'm going to discuss. I think without Ford's pardon of Nixon, you don't get Iran-Contra. Quickly, this was an illegal war waged by the Reagan administration in which they funded illegal funds to a guerrilla band in Nicaragua. This guerrilla band, known as the Contras, was intended to overthrow an established leftist government. According to the Reagan administration, right, within the sort of Reagan doctrine, should Nicaragua turn communist, right, the next domino to fall would be sort of Florida and Oklahoma and that sort of thing. So they waged this illegal war finding illegal funds to support this rebel band. It was eventually caught and exposed, but again, there was very little accountability at the highest levels of American government. Oops, my buttons aren't working. Right, two good documentaries that capture this. Well, they're really, the one on the left is actually a Hollywood film. The one on the left is also a film, but sort of documentary. If you're interested in the kind of abuses of power that were sort of went on during the Iran-Contra era, I recommend these two. We need to consider that during the 1980s, The Cosby Show was the most popular television show in America. This is an extraordinary moment in American cultural history. Bill Cosby was colloquially referred to as America's dad. And what this show does is, for the first time in American history, the experiences, the portrayal of a Black family on American television had reached that sort of level of cultural authority, cultural acceptance that was usually implicit in American situation comedies going back to like Leave It to Beaver, that great iconic show that represents the kind of model American home, right? The stability of America rested on this representation of the ideal American home in the ideal American family. During the 80s, Cosby, as I say, was able to elevate a Black family in America to that level of acceptance. It's really kind of an extraordinary moment. The problem, of course, as Americans learn later, is during this period, Bill Cosby was essentially a serial rapist, and worse, his coterie was arranging to help drug women so that Bill Cosby could abuse them later on. During the summer of 1998, Major League Baseball in America committed an unprecedented fraud. This, again, is pretty extraordinary. Now, baseball is kind of a silly game, but its history is integrated into the cultural fabric of American history. You really can't pull the two apart. So this was a massive kind of disruption and assumptions American had about sort of their relationship with this part of American culture. What I've highlighted in yellow there, you'll see these two players. The one on the left is named Mark McGuire. On the right is Sammy Sosa. What I've highlighted in yellow are the number of home runs that Mark McGuire hit over 5 years. Beginning in 1997, McGuire hit 24. That's very respectable. The next year, he hit 70. This is superhuman. The year after, 65. This again is superhuman. And then he returned to 32. Here's a picture of both Mark McGuire and Sammy Sosa testifying before Congress in 2005, during which they had to admit that during the years which they were setting these records, they were abusing steroid drugs, and that this in fact become endemic across baseball. September 1st, 2011, we all know what happened. And I think hindsight reveals that if this was not a colossal failure in American government, at the very least, it exposed certain assumptions about American exceptionalism that are now understood to be completely delusional. 3 months after 9/11, Enron collapses. Enron was the seventh largest corporation in America. It was an energy company. It specialized in natural gas, electricity, that sort of thing. It was based in Houston. Enron had remarkably close relationship with the Bush family, very close relationships with the presidential administrations of both Bush Sr. and Bush Jr. Within 7 days, Enron went bankrupt. The seventh largest company in the United States collapsed. Why did it collapse? Well, Enron had managed to achieve an accounting recognition called mark to market. they were able to claim profits that were essentially fraudulent. The accounting firm that represented Enron, which was called Arthur Anderson, was able, had sort of wrangled the legal approval where Enron could project profits that it could state were based on fact, when in fact they weren't. The entire company was one big house of fraudulent cards. And when it collapsed, it eliminated pensions and savings for thousands of employees. Right? America's response to 9/11 was what? The invasion of Iraq. This was a war that was that Americans were assured was being waged in their protection. The political banner waving essentially read that Saddam Hussein had weapons of mass destruction, and that in an era of terrorism, those weapons could easily find their way into hands of terrorists and pose a direct threat to the American homeland. The response was this political theater of shock and awe that America was going to use its technological and military might to eliminate this threat. And in one of the great abuses of political theater in American history, when Iraq was invaded, George W. Bush, or the Bush administration really, posed this photo op. President Bush lands this fighter jet. Well, the fighter jet lands on an aircraft carrier. Bush swaggers around in his flight suit, changes into a more presidential costume, stands on the deck of this aircraft carrier, and announces that the mission in Iraq is accomplished. What Americans come to learn over the succeeding months is, in fact, that none of this was true. And worse, that the entire basis of the invasion of Iraq was fraudulent. There were no weapons of mass destruction, and Saddam Hussein posed very little, if any, threat to the United States. Instead, what Americans see in this war is this constant update on the nightly news of the kind of horror and impossible confrontation that Americans faced with a home insurgency. These are the kind of videos that played out on American screens every night. Worse, it was revealed that American soldiers had engaged in abject torture of Iraqi citizens and captured soldiers, including posing prisoners in these kind of naked pyramids, just dehumanizing and illegal activities perpetrated in the name of the United States. During the same period, Tiger Woods in 1997 wins the Masters, so the most prestigious golf tournament in the United States. Like the Cosby Show, this is really an extraordinary moment in American cultural history. The Masters is played at a golf course called Augusta National Golf Course. This is outside of Atlanta. The grounds are actually a former slave plantation. Augusta is notoriously conservative and straight up racist across its history. It did not admit a Black member till 1990. It did not admit women until 2012. Tiger Woods in 1997, at the age of about 24, shows up at Augusta and wins this tournament. Again, it's this really amazing moment in American history where it looks like all the promises of America actually come to fruition, right? As a result of this, Tiger Woods becomes about the most commodified American ever, lending that wonderful smile of his for everything from cereal to watches to cars, right? As his career advances, he gets married to this Swedish model, right? Hindsight kind of reveals that there was a lot of sort of corporate interference in this relationship, right? This is really kind of the crafting of this sort of ideal American couple. And just like all these other achievements in America, Americans were shocked a few years later to learn that in fact, Tiger Woods was this serial philanderer and just sort of engaging in deeply, deeply immoral and suspicious behaviors. Once Tiger Woods' sort of downfall began, he kind of collapses into himself. And on national TV, you see this American hero arrested for driving under the influence of both alcohol and prescription pills. And I'd like to play this because it really captures this image of this American icon, this American hero, who had sort of collapsed under the weight of his own fame.
What I'd like you to do is stand with your feet together and your arms down by your side, okay? All right, put your feet all the way together just like last time. Okay. Do you know the English alphabet from A to Z?
Yes.
You do? What's your highest level of education?
Sophomore in college.
sophomore in college. Okay, with your feet together and your arms down by your side, okay? So go ahead and get there now with your arms down by your side. Okay, don't begin until I tell you to, okay? But when I tell you to, I want you to close your eyes and tilt your head backwards, okay? And you're going to recite the entire English alphabet in a slow, non-rhythmic manner, meaning you're not going to sing it, okay? Do you understand the instructions? Okay, what were the instructions?
Not to sing the national anthem backwards.
Not to sing the national anthem backwards?
That's tragic. That's tragic. Again, I provide a reference here to, it's really an excellent documentary out of HBO that really captures sort of the making of Tiger and the manipulation of sort of this image into this sort of icon of American culture. Between 1998 and 2005, Lance Armstrong wins 7 Tour de Frances. Again, this kind of superhuman feat. Additional to that, in the midst of his running these successive Tour de Frances, Lance beats cancer. He had extremely advanced testicular cancer and wasn't given much of a chance to live. Miraculously, he recovers and goes on to continue to win Tour de France championships. Like every other achievement during this decade, it turns into be this house of cards. 2013, Lance is on Oprah, finally admitting that his entire history of success in cycling was based on his abuse of, he was getting blood transfusions. He was using sort of steroid cocktails. He had basically sort of chemically produced himself to achieve these, the feats, right? Again, another documentary that I think really captures the essence of sort of greed and cynicism that was at the center of a lot of this kind of motivation. Hurricane Katrina, 2005. This is absolutely spectacular. Hurricanes don't happen overnight. You can predict a hurricane. And I remember watching this on TV very, very clearly. In the days leading up to this, the news was full of watching this hurricane approach the coast of New Orleans, right? There was no secret about where this thing was going. When Hurricane Katrina hit, it was a level 5 hurricane. It was the strongest hurricane that can be measured. And it absolutely devastated New Orleans. New Orleans, as you may know, is actually below sea level. So when the storm hit, it broke a lot of the dams and levees and much of New Orleans was flooded. Here's what was absolutely exceptional about that experience. When the storm cleared, the United States media was there to cover the results. Americans watched on live TV the effects of the show, the devastation, and really watched in kind of shock and horror as New Orleans' most displaced population, poor Black, poor white citizens, were stuck without any resource and any government aid. What Americans watched unfold on television was an absence of government. For several days, New Orleans was kind of in this liminal space of being kind of a frontier town, right? Where all of the expectations of what the US government can provide its citizens were absent. Ooh, this one may make me the most angry. During this entire period, America is experiencing what we now refer to as the opioid epidemic. And let me just take a second and explain what this is. Purdue Pharma is one of the major pharmaceutical advertising and manufacturing companies in America. In the late 80s, early 1990s, Purdue Pharma, the executives, it's one family, it's a family company, and the family essentially are the executives. Purdue decided that they could make money by selling heroin to the American people. That may sound extraordinary, but it's exactly what happened. Purdue Pharma manufactured a drug called OxyContin. OxyContin is an opioid. It is heroin-based. Now, in a kind of moment of interrelationship between corporation and government that very much recalls the collapse of Enron, Purdue Pharma was able to receive FDA, Food and Drug Administration, approval to list on their product that less than 1% of users of OxyContin will become addicted. This, of course, was completely fraudulent. And what we know has happened over the last decades, tens of thousands of Americans have died abusing opioid or opioid-related drugs. Now, what's come out more recently is just the strategy of profit that Purdue Pharma had concocted in a way to target the most vulnerable citizens some of our most vulnerable citizens in the United States. If you look in the map on the lower right, those darkest areas represent areas of America that are most that were most strongly devastated by opiate addiction. And what are those areas? At the very bottom there, you see kind of coal country. This is West Virginia, Southern Ohio, Kentucky. This is where coal is extensively mined. Just above that is Pittsburgh, right? Steel manufacturing. And above that is Detroit, right? Auto industry, again, manufacturing. These are populations and communities that are in, that rely on, at times, very dangerous manual labor. These are places people get hurt. Purdue first marketed its wonder non-addictive pain pill to these populations. And the result has been complete devastation of these communities across America. These are the two best documentaries that I found on the subject. The left is their HBO. That's kind of a straight documentary. The one on the right called Dope Sick, I think is fabulous. That's Michael Keaton there. So it's Batman. Batman plays this country doctor who experiences the opioid crisis in West Virginia. It's eight parts, but it's very well worth watching because it really captures the emotional cost of this corporate abuse on America. Then we have the financial crisis of 1998. Again, it's this weird synergy between sort of government irregulation and corporate greed, where banks offered extravagantly appealing mortgages to Americans who in turn invested in homes that they kind of simply could not afford, right? This is a very kind of American kind of scandal where somebody sort of dangles the opportunity to live above your means and everybody kind of jumps on it. But the result was a complete collapse of the American economy. Now, in the midst of all this kind of abuse of power, sort of corporate greed, government arrogance, I want to suggest very strongly to you that during these same years, America engaged what I would consider to be a kind of second documentary aesthetic. And I use the documentary aesthetic there in heavy quotes because it's I use it in reference to the scholar Astrid Boger, I think is at University of Hamburg, in her discussion of this. But let me describe basically what I mean. Originally, or sort of as Boger discussed it, America's documentary aesthetic comes out of the exigencies of the American Depression, right? Facing extreme deprivation, right? A quarter of America is unemployed. That number goes up and down. Americans are desperate. Americans are hungry. In order to address the crisis in the American economy, the government engaged in a process of it calls introducing America to Americans. It's a wonderful quote, but the strategy is this: before the government can make massive taxpayer investment in infrastructure, with the idea being that we can build our way, that the government can sort of build our way back to economic recovery, before that could be done, Americans had to develop a kind of collective consciousness, a collective sympathy for the plight of Americans coast to coast, Americans living in inner city, Americans in working in agriculture, et cetera. So in order to create this kind of culture of sort of shared sympathy, the government hires artists of various media to explore the United States and document what they see. And the results of these are really quite extraordinary. You get this entire series of guides to American cities, guides to American states, where they employed, that were written by American writers who were hired specifically by the government to do this. Photographers are hired to sort of canvas the entire of America and take pictures of the kind of plight and suffering and the realities on the ground during the Depression. And out of that comes this, of course, iconic image of the left by Dorothea Lange called Migrant Mother, where this sort of desperate mother and her kids are captured in a migrant camp in rural California. The government, of course, was not the only agency, the government was not alone, of course, in engaging in this process of sort of documenting America. American artists were, of course, quick to abandon the aesthetics of sort of high modernism and refocus their energies on shaping an American art that came out of direct engagement with American citizens. So you get these kind of epic works of art that sort of focus on the experience of ordinary Americans, probably best epitomized by Steinbeck in his Grapes of Wrath. Now, I want to suggest to you that this aesthetic is in no way limited to the Depression. I think it kind of manifests there, but it quickly extends out of the Depression into post-war America. And then I'm going to suggest advances into our own time. This is an important sort of process in that continuum. This Is Your Life was a wonderful television show. It's one of those television shows that actually started in radio, right? So its roots are very much in kind of 1930s America. And the premise of this show is very simple. Guests would appear on the show and they would essentially relive their lives as they were introduced from people and sort of props that kind of represent their lives to that point. So you're on stage and like your kindergarten teacher comes on, or your doctor comes on, or this friend you haven't seen forever comes on, and you kind of get this kind of collective memory that focuses on the life of an ordinary American. And this is what I think is most exceptional about this show, is that they did have celebrities on, but Americans rejected it. Americans wanted to hear from ordinary Americans, and really more specifically, Americans wanted to hear from Americans who had triumphed over personal adversity, right? And so looking at their, they kept files on prospective guests, and it's really interesting. You can see here that there was a file of just alcoholics, a file of prospective guests that were drug addicts. There was a file of prospective guests who had experienced divorce, right? Kind of sensational in its time. People who had been felons and had done time in prison. Americans demonstrated this kind of open appetite for absorbing the kind of challenge and experience, the adversity experienced by ordinary Americans. And it's very easy, I think, once you kind of have this idea of that kind of impulse in American culture, to see where kind of what we call today more reality TV emerges. And I would suggest to you that really the primary agent in this was the live television broadcast of the O.J. Simpson trial. If you don't have that, you don't get the whole Kardashian phenomenon, right? The father, the Kardashian, was one of O.J.'s lawyers. And the kind of the way that this sensational trial played out live on TV just open the doors to sort of years of subsequent sort of reinvention of this kind of genre of reality television. But I think what's important to note is that a lot of its focus was on these kind of subcultures in America, right? I can list, for example, the family on the right there, this Duck Dynasty. This is a family from Louisiana who made a fortune manufacturing duck calls. I don't know if that translates. They made a fortune making whistles that sound like ducks, whistles that kind of go, right? And then ducks come and you shoot the ducks. And basically the premise of this show is you have these very wealthy hillbillies and you follow their lives as they go hunting and they eat squirrel and they do all these kinds of things, right? But the point is that it's a similar kind of engagement and focus with what's assumed to be kind of the average American life, right? Okay. While that is going on, you have this other kind of historical backdrop emerging. At the center of this is Ken Burns. And I don't think you can underestimate the importance of Ken Burns to understanding American culture today. Between 1990 and he's still alive and working, Ken Burns kind of reinvented American history, certainly anyway, within a kind of populist conception, right? And really what I think Ken Burns' genius is, he was able to take primary sources, so diaries, letters, photographs, that kind of thing. And he was able to create a documentary that focused exclusively on these materials and forced Americans to look painfully closely for long periods of time at some of the greatest failures in their cultural history. Right? This is really, really important to understand. The beginning in 1990, that Ken Burns is sort of reinventing popular American history, let me go back for just a second, if in no other way, by suggesting that these new categories are in fact American history, right? The West, jazz, baseball, that these subcultures in America were in fact integrated into the overall product of American culture. That in itself was pretty new. But what Burns was able to do was claim to present these experiences in a kind of novelistic narrative that focuses exclusively on the primary sources. And I want to play about a 1 minute clip from the first episode of the Civil War. It's on the right. But I want to preface it by saying, again, this is one of these really kind of extraordinary moments in American culture. 7 million households tuned into this, right? That's households, meaning the people who watched it could be more up into the 20 millions or something like that. That's extraordinary in and of itself, but it competed with Sunday night football, which is kind of an institution in America, right? That day in 1990, the Chicago Bears played the Minnesota Vikings, right? Concurrent with that, 7 million households in America decided to watch this new documentary on the Civil War, and this is what they saw.
Yeah. No day ever dawns for the slave, a freed black man wrote, nor is it looked for. For the slave, it is all night forever. One white Mississippian was more blunt. I'd rather be dead, he said, than be a nigger on one of these big plantations.
Okay, but you get the aesthetic. Burns makes you focus unflinchingly on some of the greatest horrors, the greatest failures in American history, and makes you sort of engage them in almost this kind of sensory way that pulls from all of these primary sources. It's a remarkable approach to American documentary, and it has thrived in this culture across the last 20 years, okay? So within this kind of culture, the context of this kind of conscience of crisis, this investiture in sort of reinventing and sort of studying American subcultures, in January 10th of 1999, this happened, and American culture, I would suggest, changed. Opening sequence of The Sopranos is really one of the best pieces of American art, I think, over the last 30 years, at least. It really captures the kind of American zeitgeist at that turn of the century moment. And in order to kind of describe that, I want to suggest this still, where Tony Soprano sort of is emerging from the Holland Tunnel, and he's looking in his rearview mirror or side mirror back into Manhattan. What's the point? Well, the point is, this is not going to be a show about the conventional kind of culture power structures. It's not going to be a show that is concerned with, let me pause for just a second. It is a show that is going to literally leave in its rearview mirror the conventional centers of American culture, the central assumptions about American economic exceptionalism, about American cultural exceptionalism. And it's going to turn its back and instead investigate the realities of a very different America in New Jersey. Now, implicit with that, of course, is that the show is going to rewrite the American sort of Italian mafia genre, right? It is literally, again, leaving in its rearview mirror the experiences of The Godfather or Goodfellas, two of the kind of iconic shows, films that have to do with the experience of Italian immigrant families, right? Both shows are emphatically New York City center, right? This is not that. Now, we have to understand why Americans love this kind of sort of mob mafia film fiction. And it's really pretty simple. What this genre posits or explains or illustrates is an individual American and their triumph over a society that is both corrupt and discriminatory, right? I mean, there's no great revelation in that insight, but that's the essence of it, is it's the individual relying on their own wits, right, to overcome a society that is conspiring against them, right? It's very much baseball, right? It's this one batter versus nine, right? Americans love that dynamic. And that's very much strikes the center of what's going on, in these American narratives. Of course, in doing that, it raises fundamental questions about the very promise of ideals, right? These films, these novels, The Sopranos, they really strike at sort of questioning the fundamental promise of America. And of course, the experience is universal. So it's readily, everyone can kind of identify that, right? Mob stories have to do with the Jewish mob in New York back in the 20s, the Irish mob in North Chicago during the 1930s, right? This is an inclusive experience that Americans can relate to. Right. And I want to sort of, as a point of departure, let me just, it's a way of demarcating just how distinct and how new The Sopranos is. I want to suggest to you, or at least call your attention to The Godfather, and which debuted in 1972 amidst the chaos of Vietnam and Watergate and all of that. And it's got this wonderful first line, "I believe in America," right? Despite the sort of craziness of this sort of historical moment, there's this. The movie starts with this fundamental promise, "I believe in America." What did Americans see in Tony Soprano? What did Americans see in The Sopranos? Well, here's essentially our introduction. This is the first scene of The Sopranos. Where is Tony? He's in a psychiatrist's office. And what is he doing? He is confessing his sort of illusions about the promise of America. Let me play this segment.
Look, it's impossible for me to talk to a psychiatrist.
Any thoughts at all on why you blacked out?
I don't know. Stress, maybe.
About what?
I don't know. The morning of the day I got sick, I've been thinking. It's good to be in something from the ground floor. I came too late for that, I know. But lately I'm getting the feeling that I came in at the end. The best is over.
Many Americans, I think, feel that way.
I think about my father. He never reached the heights like me. But in a lot of ways he had it better. He had his people. They had their standards, they had pride. Today, what do we got?
What's there? It's really quite extraordinary. There is no more promise of America, right? There is a disillusionment with America and a realization that I'm going to have to rely on my own sort of individualities to find my way in this very changing, broken American culture, right? And it's all about the internal. Right, you start with that wonderful close-up of Tony's eye, and then it pulls back, and he's kind of stasis. Right, he's just kind of stuck in this malaise of American culture, right at the change of the millennia. And the Sopranos is really an exploration about how accepted American cultures are going to thrive in this changed America. Right now, I want to get into more sort of talking about how these shows. What unifies these four shows that I believe that represent this kind of changed American aesthetic? And I want to start with this. And this is a quote that may be familiar to many of us. But Hemingway claimed that all of American literature comes out of one book, right? Mark Twain, meaning that the sort of consummate American figure is that Huck Finn figure. And why is that so important? It's the picaresque, right? It's the individual American who can overcome the challenges of society based fully on their wit, right? Their sense of innate self. It does not require formal education. It requires more kind of individual essence is how you sort of thrive in American society. And there's that wonderful line in the very beginning of Huck Finn where Huck says, "The widow Douglas took me for her son and allowed that she would civilize me, but it was rough living in the house, right? Huck does not want to be civilized. Huck belongs outdoors, surviving by his wits. And this captures, I think, that idea of how you reconcile individual freedom with the needs of a collective society that is broken, identifies the experience of the protagonist in all of these shows. It is a revaluation of the American picaresque to fit the challenges of a 21st century American culture. And Americans loved this. Americans thrived watching these new explorations of the individual. And so when I say that, I want to say this applies to any of the characters that appear in these shows. And it's not a gender thing. This is very much gender neutral, right? The women are demonstrating this new kind of strong picaresque that I think is very new in American society. So you've got this sort of unified revaluation of the individual and really the extent or the lengths to which an individual is allowed to go to achieve and to thrive in society. And that implies maybe that you have to sacrifice conventional moralities. You might have to sacrifice, or you might have to operate outside the law a little bit, right? That all these kind of, there's new rules to the game. And that to achieve your full individual agency, it's kind of expected that you're going to be operating on the fringes of society and maybe illegally. And that's okay. And that's what you see sort of celebrated in many of these shows, right? And so let me transition towards this. This is what really defines these shows. The first is these shows demand an unprecedented commitment by the viewer. You have to watch, you cannot watch these shows. You can only rewatch them. In that way, they really kind of assume the dynamics of literature, that these are not, this is not passive entertainment. This is to be studied. This is to be felt. This is to be analyzed. And as an example of this, I want to call your attention to this. This is from The Wire. The character there is McNulty. He's the main detective featured in the show. And in the clip, he's meeting with the sergeant, and I want us to please focus on the kind of character and personality of the sergeant in this conversation.
Major, we got a good shot to clear a couple of cases here. One thing.
We're not here to talk cases, McNulty. I don't care about your cases. Sit. Relax. I'm a reasonable guy. In fact, everywhere I go, people say to me, Bill Rawls, you are a reasonable fucking guy. Am I right, Jay?
You are reasonable, sir.
Yes. Yes, I am. And because your sergeant knows me to be reasonable, he came in here a couple of weeks ago and reasoned with me, right, Jay?
We reasoned. We did.
We reasoned that despite his negligible Irish ancestry and a propensity to talk out of turn, Jimmy McNulty is a good worker. Probably worth saving.
Major, I'm not...
He's a good-looking kid, huh?
I think you get the sense of it, right? You kind of have this kind of hyper-masculinized sergeant who's kind of pushing around his subordinate and sort of putting him back in line, right? And I love that the sergeant calls attention to this family photo you see on his desk with his wife and his son. That appears in season one, episode two of the series. This happens in season three, episode 10. And let me set this up a bit. There is a gangster who is traveling from gay bar to gay bar in Baltimore, looking for another gangster who is gay, right? And he wants to hit this gangster. He wants to kill him, right? The gangster wanders into this one gay bar in Baltimore, and this is what he sees.
Fuck you coming up behind me.
Sorry.
That was the sergeant at the very end, turning on his ball, sort of this cameo, turning on his sort of bar stool and taking a quick look there. That guy, that sergeant from season one, episode two, is gay. This is the only insight you get to that across the entire run of the show. It appears in season three, episode 10, and it is so easily missed. And all the shows contain this kind of level of nuance. It requires a kind of investiture on the part of the viewer that I think is at this point equal to the experience of literature. The other thing these show is a fascination with hyper-realism, again, emerging out of that kind of America's documentary aesthetic. You see on the left, this is kind of the, it's the set of the Sopranos. And the two characters at the bottom there in yellow, those are characters on the Sopranos who did prison time for living the life of being in the mob, right? The Wire was the same. A lot of the actors were recruited from the streets of Baltimore. And the reason for that was this kind of documentary aesthetic, this fascination with the sort of subcultures of America. America wanted to see itself raw. And these shows provided that opportunity. Something like Deadwood is similarly concerned with the kind of hyper-realism. It is a kind of historical documentary in many ways. All of these characters are real people. The institutions they visit, the Gem Saloon, these were real places. And the show was assiduously researched in archives and libraries across the United States. It's really quite a fascinating manipulation of history into drama, right? It's a profoundly literary technique. Now, what else do these shows share? They show a continuum of literary and cultural references. Let me return to The Wire quickly. David Simon, the creator of The Wire there, you see, was really a writer before he wrote for television. He wrote kind of novelistic studies of inner city Baltimore, right? He was a reporter for the Baltimore Sun on the crime beat. And this kind of novelistic approaches to understanding how broken inner city America was sort of manifest in these two novels on the right before The Wire was ever considered as a serial drama. And really, it's impossible not to align what David Simon is doing with the kind of established practice in American literary history of taking lived experience and really lived crime, true crime, and reinventing it into a kind of combination journalistic novelistic form, right? Most famously, this was explored by Truman Capote in Cold Blood, but certainly Norman Mailer is doing the same thing in The Executioner Song in 1979. And as I say, this is very much a continuum of the American literary tradition in serial drama form. This is the opening scene of The Wire. This is your first introduction to The Wire.
So your boy's name is what?
Snot.
You call the guy Snot?
Snot Boogie. Yeah.
Snot Boogie. You like the name?
What?
Snot Boogie. This kid whose mama went to the trouble of christening him Omar Isaiah Betts?
You know, he forgets his jacket. So his nose starts running, and some asshole, instead of giving him a Kleenex, he calls him Snot. So he's Snot forever.
Doesn't seem fair.
Life just be that way, I guess.
I think it's impossible not to see the thumbprints of just basic Shakespeare strategy in this opening scene. You've got this sort of disorienting scene, right? The world is completely out of joint, right? As Shakespeare would say, a body of a young kid lying in the middle of the street of inner city Baltimore, this kind of wasteland of broken housing around them. And what are all the lines, the initial lines? They're all questions. It's very, very Shakespeare. Why? The point is to sort of instill this sense of disorientation, the sense of confusion, the sense of a world in disarray that the show is then going to kind of illustrate as it unfolds across the following seasons. Other kind of literary references specific to The Wire. It's a wonderful scene in the first episode, in season one, episode three, where some of the gangsters are playing, they're using chess pieces to play checkers, right? And one of the older gang members comes and is, you know, what are you doing? And he starts teaching them chess. And it's this incredible allusion to Eliot and the way he uses the imagery and the kind of functionality of a game of chess to kind of to deconstruct society and sort of consider how the different pieces sort of all choreograph together and how there are hierarchies in society and all of that. It's really in a wonderfully elusive moment where you see that kind of same exercise being transposed into the hierarchies of the drug game, right? That's really, I think, what's going on in this scene. And to bring the matter full circle, I think David Simon, I mean, Eliot is exploring sort of European culture after the devastation of the First World War. I think David Simon is exploring Baltimore after the ravages of the war on drug. I think that's the point that's here. Let me go to Mad Men just a second, because again, the cultural references are just implicit and everywhere. And there's really three primary texts or authors that are at the center of Mad Men. First is John Cheever. As you may know, the main character of Mad Men, Don Draper, lives in Ossining. That's where Cheever lived, commutes into New York every day for his job at this Madison Avenue ad agency. But the show is really concerned with the kind of malaise, the kind of culture of consensus, the culture of conformity, the lack of individuality that was the American suburb in the post-war world, right? The easiest point of entry into understanding Mad Men, I firmly believe, is understanding The Swimmer, you know, John Cheever's famous novella or short story. The other two influences come from women. Sylvia Plath, The Bell Jar, her experience, right, her biographical experience working in, I think it was a magazine or a newspaper in Manhattan after she graduated college, and the experiences of a woman working in that environment as relayed in The Bell Jar are absolutely the center of how a lot of the female characters in Mad Men kind of negotiate the world of Madison Avenue. And of course, the feminine mystique by Betty Friedan is the other prominent text, because what you have certain women in Mad Men negotiating the sort of minefield of corporate America. You have other women who are sort of stuck in that sort of stasis of domesticity, right? That stasis of the American housewife. That really comes to fruition, I think, most clearly in this wonderful clip from Mad Men. Let me play this.
I'll be right up. Hello. Sorry to bother you so late. It's Don Draper.
Oh, hello, Mr. Draper.
No, it's not too late at all.
Glad to hear that.
Well, I had a very interesting hour with your wife this afternoon.
She's a very anxious young woman. I think you're doing the right thing.
Don Draper, the protagonist who's on the phone there, is married to Betty Draper, his wife, right? The wife goes upstairs. And who does Don Draper talk to? His wife's psychiatrist, because of course, the psychiatrist has to sort of mediate all of their diagnoses through the husband. And then you get that wonderful, very Sylvia Plath focus on the kitchen, of course, the hearth within the kitchen, right? The oven, which of course is where Sylvia Plath tragically ended her own life. And finally, as a way of concluding, I want to suggest this clip from Deadwood. If we really want to understand what these shows are about, I think it really is best encapsulated in this clip here. And let me set this up so we understand. This is a funeral. It's a burial. And it's a burial for Wild Bill Hickok. Wild Bill Hickok was probably among America's first celebrities. He was one of these kind of Wild West gunslingers whose fame converged with the kind of fruition of newspapers in the 19th century, with the telegraph, all these kind of new instruments of communication and journalism. And he kind of becomes this kind of iconic figure of the American West. He, in real life, he was killed, he was shot in Deadwood, and the same occurs on the show, on the fictionalized version of this. He's being laid to rest. And I want you to listen very carefully, please, to what the preacher here describes, or how he sort of hopes to advance beyond the loss of Wild Bill.
Mr. Hickok will lie beside two brothers. One he likely killed, the other he killed for certain, and he's been killed now in turn.
So much blood. And on the battlefields of the brothers' war, I saw more blood than this, and asked then after the purpose, and did not know, and don't know the purpose now. But know now to testify that, not knowing, I believe. St. Paul tells us, by one spirit are we all baptized into one body.
whether we be Jew or Gentile, bond or free, and have all been made to drink into one spirit. For the body is not one member, but many. He tells us, the eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee. Nor again, the head to the feet, I have no need of thee. Nay, much more those members of the body which seem to be more feeble, and those members of the body which we think of as less honorable, all are necessary. He says that there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care one to another. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. I believe in God's purpose, not knowing it. I ask Him, moving in me, to allow me to see His will. I ask Him, moving in others, to allow them to see it.
Okay. It's an absolutely extraordinary speech that I think captures the essence of these shows, or rather to reverse that, to the set of emotions, the set of anxieties, the set of corruptions that emerge out of these previous decades in American culture, the delusion, the fraud, the cynicism combined with this fascination in history really comes to fruition here. And what's happening is the preacher is asking the question that is fundamental to all these shows and really to American culture in the first decade of the 21st century. And that is, how is America going to function like a body? How are these collective parts, some desirable, some undesirable, but all essential, how is America going to come together and function as a whole body? But it's going to have to figure out how to function in absence of its heroes, right? Wild Bill is being buried. The great hero of the show is killed in a very kind of bland and gross way. He's being lowered into the ground. The preacher here does not survive the first series, or he dies in the final episode. He becomes very, very sick and his body just collapses. So the fundamental question is here is, how are Americans living within this kind of very broken or maybe kind of corrupted society in absence of moral authority, in absence of conventional heroes? And if in the case of Deadwood, in absence of government, how can America still function with the collective? How can the American individual still exercise their full freedom of their full agency, their full freedom, and still remain involved and connected to the whole, right? Within the kind of context of this very, very stressed culture. Now, my final slide is this. If I've done this right, I may have communicated that my title is wrong. I can't get this right yet, and it will take time to get this right. But I want to suggest to you, as a way of ending, that what we're really talking about is not television, right? Television's on the left, and some of you are probably too young, but that thing above the TV is an antenna, right? Where you kind of, you're able to sort of beam into your house, like maybe three networks, right? That what you watch on TV is kind of being decided for you, right? That's not the space we're in. The space we're in today, Americans can choose, anybody can choose thousands of things to watch on TV, right? It's really viewer driven. And Americans were drawn to this new exchange that it's not television. I'm not sure what it is yet, but television is exactly right. And of course, I don't think these things are literature. They are literary and they are informed by traditions of American literature, but these shows aren't literature. They are what they are, right? They're a combination of production and post-production and text at the same time.
So thank you, Ben, for a wonderful lecture. We still have a little bit of time for Q&A. So I was kind of thinking about the picaresque novel and this kind of, let's say, way of thinking about American culture, especially kind of important American text through the lens of the picaresque and, you know, this kind of ruffian-like character, often from lower classes, kind of, you know, climbing to the top and kind of being on his or, you know, more perhaps really on her own. And of course, yeah, I definitely see that in the kind of, let's say, new television that we get since The Sopranos. But I was also thinking, how do you relate the picaresque and the kind of the picaresque character to the kind of anti-hero character that we also see in The Wire and Breaking Bad and Desperate Housewives, Mad Men, etc. So do you feel there is a switch here from the kind of the picaresque character to the to the anti-hero, or is this something different? Is the anti-hero a kind of update on the picaresque, especially in the light of what you've been saying about the kind of moral climate of the US of the last 30 years? So Tiger Woods, Bill Cosby, and O.J. Simpson, and I forgot the guy who cycled, the white guy,
Lance Armstrong,
the cyclist. So I was kind of wondering about that, whether, you know, is the anti-hero an update on the picaresque character, or are these two separate things? Like, where does the anti-hero fit in this narrative? Sorry if it's a little bit mumbled.
No, that's wonderful, and I appreciate that. The under-hero being who? Could you give me the examples of who the under-hero is?
I mean, anti-hero. So, like, anti-hero in, like, Walter White in Breaking Bad, or, you know...
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I would suggest to you that my suggestion would be more this, that what Walter White represents is, I don't think it's anti-hero. I think he's heroic until he breaks bad. Let me explain that just a little bit. I think that Americans sort of identify initially with Walter White as heroic, as they would with Tony Soprano and some of these others, in the sense that they figured out a way to thrive amidst this kind of corrupt culture, right? And who's Walter White? He's a dedicated high school teacher, right, who gets cancer and whose health insurance is unable to provide treatment. So what does he do? He takes his skill set, he's a chemistry teacher, and he starts manufacturing meth, right? And in the context of the America I'm describing, I think that's kind of like, well, okay, if Purdue Pharma can do it, he can do it, right? Why is there privilege in these kind of centers of power in American culture? We want to see average Americans thrive in that same way. Does that make sense? So he's kind of heroic in that he his approach to success in American culture is really no different than what we've seen playing out at the higher levels of culture. Does that make sense? So in that way, he's heroic. But of course, as the show advances, I feel Breaking Bad really follows the process of addiction. Walter White being addicted to life and money and all of these things, and it's going to end where addiction ends, and that's sort of death and misery and all that kind of thing. And sort of when he breaks bad, he becomes this very dark kind of character. But I think it's more of a show about a hero who fails than it is kind of about an anti-hero. Does that make sense? I mean, it's kind of dark, but that's the kind of heroic act. It's kind of a heroic act within kind of dark American cult context.
I think when you kind of switch the context a little bit, like when we kind of have Walter placed in the kind of corrupt reality of the US, that then right. it makes sense that his type of heroism is different than you would what you would normally associate with kind of heroic behavior, right? Of course, you could argue that there were kind of glimpses of his kind of being corrupted already in the first season and the kind of earlier ones, but of course, it's also what, as you've said, that we don't really get that when we're watching the first or second seasons. We only get it when we get to the end, when there is like no turning back, and this is the kind of breaking point, so to speak, right? So, although I think you can argue kind of both ways, kind of depending on, again, like which kind of breadcrumbs do you follow?
Right. Yeah. Sure.
But definitely yes. Okay. Let's maybe turn to questions in the chat, because I don't want to kind of, you know, hug the mic. So we have I think one from Bulent Ackman about Seinfeld, and I thought Seinfeld was about where comics get their ideas or comedians. Yeah. Can you comment on this? I guess we all know the episode where they pitch a show about nothing.
Right. I don't know. I don't know if I can. My knowledge of Seinfeld isn't very vast. I always remember this one exchange, and I thought it was hilarious when it happened. And it just kind of seemed like a good bookend to start with. I wasn't trying to suggest somehow that Seinfeld, this kind of show about nothing, sort of has some influence on later American aesthetics. I don't know if it's there so much. It was just, it very much defines Americans' relationship with television in the final decade of the 20th century. And the point is how quickly that gets reevaluated, how quickly television evolves into something else right? Beginning in just about 2000 and or in 1999. That's really, I haven't thought about Seinfeld in any way where it could be like, I could analyze it or something like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I think the kind of another show that kind of gives that kind of similar vibe is Community, where there's you know, you get quite a few episodes about, you know, kind of writing a show and kind of sitcom. So I think it's like a staple of certain type of this kind of deconstructed sitcom type of comedy.
One thing I would add, though, is I think the shows that you could watch that are really revealing about this moment in American television are shows like The Office or maybe Modern Family. I don't know if those shows are kind of well known, but that was kind of a genre of show over the same decade that I'm talking about, where part of the appeal was that it was a supposed kind of documentary, right? I mean, The Office is all about, there's a documentary crew, they're filming the whole thing, right? And yeah, it's just a sitcom, and it's a wonderful sitcom, and it's brilliant, and it's wonderful, and all these things, but it's the form that I think is very revealing, is that it remains, the illusion is, these are ordinary Americans living ordinary lives, right? And Modern Family was the same thing. Here's this kind of American family that looks like many American families, and all American families are nuts, right? And it just kind of plays that out. But it does it in this kind of documentary form. And that's where I think you see the greatest resonance with these shows, and these kind of really this fascination with this just in-depth, real kind of nuts and bolts grit, right, in exposure of American life.
We have one more question about Walter White, but before maybe we move to that, let's maybe hear a question from Michał Zabłocki, because he's raised his hand. So
I have a question, because earlier you mentioned that Americans watch what they want on the TV, not what someone chooses for them. What did you mean by that? Did you mean VOD services, or did you mean something else by that?
No. Exactly. DOD is direct on demand. Is that
VOD?
Okay. Yeah.
Services like Netflix or HBO.
And I mean, the thing I didn't have time to really get into, but another important component to this, I think we should talk about just HBO. I mean, that's where this genius kind of came out of. And I don't think anyone's really gotten into HBO to understand. I mean, there have been some really good books about HBO, but I don't think there's really been a chance to get into the kind of archive and really kind of understand what was going on there. But yes, the idea that there were these new delivery systems that were outside the reach of a public censorship's not the right word, but they were outside the reach of kind of the way networks need to be concerned about their content, right? HBO's thing was, it's not television, it's HBO. It's really kind of a brilliant, ad. It's kind of a brilliant way to sort of market yourself. But no, the point was that all of a sudden you've got this opportunity to choose from. Man, today, who knows how many DOD kind of services there are, right? Where you kind of have a hyper-competitive market where Americans are more kind of, you know, are able to sort of select from this overwhelming menu what it is that they kind of feel most attracted to, right? And I think these shows kind of distinguish themselves in that way.
Okay, let's maybe return to the chat box, and then we'll have one more question from Nadia, because we have two comments on Walter White, so kind of going back to Breaking Bad. So I'm going to read them out for the recording. So Walter White is a villain protagonist. He wants to make something. I imagine this is distinct from television antiheroes. And then a longer comment from Bartłomiej, referring still to the character of Walter White, is almost three-dimensional in a way. From the point of view of the character himself, that is Walter, he is a hero, the one who won. From the point of view of other characters in the series, he's a villain, a ruthless and vicious criminal. But looking from the kind of meta perspective, that is our own, we see him through the prism of a literary character or anti-hero. So, he kind of a villain, a protagonist, anti-hero or hero, kind of depending on the perspective.
Right. No, it's a really well sort of asked question. I think we're quickly kind of getting into the area of kind of interpretive context, right? That he's kind of all of these things. The easiest way I've understood Walter White is that he's Macbeth. And I think the show is very clear of aligning its kind of a pattern of the tragedy with Macbeth. You get that wonderful first scene where they're choking on the air in the RV and they're driving through the desert. You have no idea what's going on. Walter White spills out of the van. He starts making this confession. What I see in that is just sort of clear references to Macbeth. You kind of have this foggy, everything's out of order, you can't even see. And then he comes out and has these kind of predictive confession. And he makes these kind of predictions over time, and they all kind of come true, right? And he's a character who I think Americans identify with, because he knows he's not going to get away with it in the end, right? He knows it's going to have consequences. He's going to have to answer for this behavior, and he ultimately does, but he can't stop, right? I mean, that's in his most essence, I think that's Walter White. White, the tragedy is he tries to do what Tony Soprano does and sort of reconcile his professional life, meth dealer, with family life, right? And it just becomes increasingly irreconcilable until it sort of spins out of control. And so that's kind of my view on Walter White. The one thing I do think Walter does more than other of the protagonists is that these shows do a wonderful job. And again, I think this fits very neatly into their historical context of you see the way that kind of the effects of corruption infect all levels of society. Right? These characters' behavior have massive repercussions in places in society you wouldn't expect, right? Don Draper's behavior affects people's behavior he's never met, right? All these characters, their kind of corruption, their attitudes, their cynicism becomes kind of cancerous and expands as these shows go on. And I think in doing that, they're sort of studying what's been going on in American culture. With you have all this corruption at the top, what do you think is going to happen, right? Does that make sense? That this is sort of going to permeate all aspects of our culture. And I don't know if that answers the question directly, but that's kind of my view on Walter White.
Thank you. Before we move to the next questions, I wanted to say that I think Walter White has this kind of transnational appeal to a certain, type of person. Because I remember my father telling me when Breaking Bad was first released that he identifies with Walter White. Like, that was his pitch for me to watch the film, the first season. I was like, no, thank you, I'll pass. I kind of returned to it years later. But I think he changed his mind in the second season or third. But there's something, of this kind of universal appeal there. Okay, we have a question from Nadia.
Hi, I have a question. It's about the appeal of villainous heroes, because especially in YA literature, and it's become pretty much a trend to put the villains as heroes. And I was going to ask about why is it so appealing, especially among young people, and where do you think this is going?
Oh, wow, what a great question. I have no idea. Where it's going, I have no idea. Where it's coming from is I just think this kind of early 21st century angst, right? This kind of anxiety, this, what's going on in the United States and really around the world is a convergence of a lot of things, of course, but we've kind of lost the stability of print, right? And so we're living in this sort of interconnected world where there are no editors and all this. So you've got this whole kind of inundation sort of absence of a moral center, of a truth center, right? And so these characters are negotiating a world that is sort of generating obstacles. The paths to success, the paths to happiness that Americans were kind of sold on and accepted during the 20th century are really no longer there, or they have been vastly complicated by either kind of hyper competition or sort of different challenges in 21st century life. And I think that's what these characters are up against. And I think the anti-hero is kind of a character who learns to negotiate those things. Let me suggest this. This is kind of the way I've sort of looked at it. I would suggest that some of these characters are anti-hero in 20th century contexts, but maybe more heroic in 21st century contexts. I think that's what I'm trying to explain, if that makes sense. And I think the attraction to is just really this kind of collective frustration, anxiety about not knowing really what the kind of paths to happiness and success are in this sort of new 21st century life of ours, right? And I think as all that gets negotiated, there's a kind of attraction that people are kind of figuring it out, even if they have to engage in sort of immorality and illegal acts to kind of get there. Does that make sense? That the kind of ends justify the means. What that means in terms of where we're going, man, I don't know. When you said why, were you talking about youth literature? Was the question more about young?
It was about literature in general, but this is like a trend in, especially in young yeah. literature, YA, young adult.
Yeah.
It's so common that pretty much every book these days has a protagonist who either has a love interest who is an embodiment of an anti-hero, or is themselves an anti-hero.
Yeah. Yeah, I think you're exactly right. What if I suggested this way? I think one of the things these shows are concerned with and really explicate very clearly is that we live in a world without heroes. Does that make sense? I mean, every American hero has been turned out to be kind of fraudulent in some way over the last couple of decades. I mean, it was really shocking in the United States, or maybe because I live in Los Angeles, when Kobe Bryant was killed, right? The famous basketball player. I mean, yes, that's really sad. But the extent to which this memorial just sort of consumed America for like months on end was absolutely overwhelming. And I just think it sort of proves this point that I just don't know who our heroes are anymore. Does that make sense? And we're sort of so desperate to look for this kind of, to sort of find new heroes that we're clinging to weird things. So it kind of makes sense that this sort of attraction to the anti-hero, right? Makes a lot of sense in that context to me.
We have two more comments on this kind of anti-hero, villain, protagonist. I'm going to read them. The latest one is from Dominika, who basically says, in my opinion, villains or anti-heroes are usually written as more complex characters than heroes or good boys, girls, and people like them. And I think we can kind of all agree, right? I mean, who doesn't love the Sandman, for instance? And then Bullent adds that the tragedy of Macbeth is one of nobility brought low by greed. But semantics aside, can we hear your view on the contrast between picaresque, so Han Solo, for instance, versus the anti-hero, Taylor Durden from Fight Club, Cornelius? I think it has to do with creation versus destruction, and heroes uphold social values. If those values like endless growth, consumption, waste are no longer accepted, what do villains offer?
Oh, yeah. It's a great question. I understand that. Let me say first, I mean, I don't... all of these characters are very complex. I'm not suggesting these are not binary characters. These are not people who there's good or there's bad, and they kind of reconcile them in some way. That's not it at all. I mean, I think maybe a clearer way of trying to say what I'm trying to, the kind of atmosphere of these shows is just to suggest that there is no binary anymore. There is no black and white. There is no good and even. There's this endless shades of gray, and these characters kind of come in and out of those shades as they see fit, as they're able to sort of put together what they need to do to sort of survive in culture. And I think that's sort of a general kind of disorientation, right? In a society that may increasingly lack the binary good or bad, you know, you're sort of all negotiating these sort of nebulous spaces of increasing gray. What was the other? I'm not sure I understand.
I think we are a little bit below with Bullent asking about the picaresque versus the anti-hero. And does it have to do anything with creation and destruction, for instance?
Basically, what I meant was, given that the picaresque always has a noble character like Don Quixote, Han Solo, they may be roguish, they may be scoundrels, but ultimately they do the right thing. You've got the anti-hero who is either amoral or chaotic neutral, who, for example, Tyler Durden wants to tear things down. I wanted to hear your opinion on how you contrast the picaresque versus the anti-hero, because I think that many of my students, I'm a teacher at the ASC, are not clear about precisely what an anti-hero is. They've heard that Catcher in the Rye and Holden Caulfield is an anti-hero. I disagree. An anti-hero is someone like the detectives. What was his name? It's a long time since I've read Dashiell Hammett.
Maltese Falcon.
Sam Spade for me is an anti-hero because he's exposing and destroying structures, but You know, he's doing the right thing for the wrong reasons very often. Right. And I think that's what an anti-hero does. You know, maybe he's not the best example, but Tyler Durden certainly is. I mean, for me, he's some kind of proto-neo-fascist. As a character, although I enjoy the novel, it's literature. So what's your take? Yes.
Okay, thank you so much. I think I understand. I think I'm understanding. That's really interesting. What do we think maybe about,
I'll give you a Band-Aid, Sonia. She cut her finger.
You have a crisis.
I'm listening.
Okay. Band-Aid crisis. I just think what I'm starting to think is that these. I think I'm struggling to sort of address these kinds of questions because. This isn't a wrong comment or anything like that. It's just I'm trying to think about if the characters you described have a place in 21st century.
Well, it's a good point, and I'm sorry to interrupt, but we're not gonna hold you to it in the sense that we're asking for your opinion, and we understand that you're a little bit on the spot. There's 150 people listening to you right now. But just there's 150 people listening to you right now. whatever you feel off the cuff, because you know when it comes to many of your references, I think we're about the same age. I remember growing up when everybody watched the same show at the same time, and that was the only time to do it. So there was a monoculture in Canada, and you know Toronto is basically the United States with different currency.
Right.
But so they don't really understand how the choice has atomized viewing. And there was one reviewer who said that you would need 2 years to watch all of the must-see television released in a single year, that it's physically impossible and that we have to choose. And I think you chose, and this is my take because I've been listening very closely to your talk and it's been very interesting. I think you chose the moment of Seinfeld as a moment of, in a sense, the previous situation comedy model had gone as far as it could go, and we needed a new structure. And that's where and into this vacuum, we had this new thing, because I think it was Seinfeld himself in Comedians in Cars Getting Coffee, who was discussing with Larry David that it was that they initially did it for a way to dramatize where comics get their ideas. And that's why it always begins with stand-up. And then that stand-up actually relates to the events that happen in the subsequent series. So back to the original issue with your take on anti-heroes and hero villains and picaresque characters. Even like, for example, in television today, The Mandalorian versus Boba Fett. For me, those are both rogues, but Boba Fett's journey and character arc are from, I would argue, an anti-hero to a hero. But where is the television anti-hero, the genuine, in your opinion, amoral, chaotic, destructive in the sense that they're creating something by tearing something down?
Here's my thinking. I love the question, and thanks for setting up the world that we both experienced before Netflix. But yes, you're exactly right in everything you're saying, of course, is that I think with Seinfeld and sort of with the entry to the new millennium, television has exhausted all of its kind of normative references, right? All of its normative expectations. And you get that sort of combination of this really dispensation in history with new technologies. And you have this entirely new environment that comes to us on our television screens, but it's not television, right? And kind of, or I would suggest it's not television. I'm gonna go out on a limb and think as I talk here. Can I have license to do that? I'm gonna suggest that maybe the anti-hero in all of this are the kind of structures within society that have proven to be either corrupt or cynical or have been exposed to just being kind of straight up fraudulent or based on just extreme avarice and greed. Does that make sense? I mean, what if we consider that there's, it's kind of like that kind of naturalist aesthetic where the individual is up against, you know, forces beyond their control. I just think what these shows are about is that it's these characters that are up against an American culture, an American society that has sort of generated these structures of fraud, of deceit, of sort of the conventional institutions that Americans rely on have either proven to be insufficient or outright corrupt. So I think what I'm thinking as I'm talking here is that that many of these characters are kind of more heroic. It's just they're up against the kind of maybe the anti-hero sort of assumes the dimensions of a kind of broken culture, broken political system, broken sort of, you know, social systems that sort of in this new kind of broken space, that's the challenge. That's the process. Does that make sense?
Well, it does make sense to me. So, and I think it was a wonderful answer.
They're really good questions,
and love the questions. We still have a couple of them, but I think we'll have to kind of give them a rest because we are already past the time limit. And so it's because it's been 90 minutes, so or more than that. So so thank you so much, Ben, yes, and thank you everyone for asking so many great questions. And we had such a lively discussion, you know, over I think over half an hour long. So that's great, really.